Welcome back, folks. This is Tom O'Brien of TFNN. Hope everyone's having a great day out there, safe day, and let's, of course, make it a great night. Our guest today, folks, is Mr. Sean Boyle. Sean is the Vice Chairman, Chief Executive Officer, and Director of Agnico Eagle. Trades in the New York Stock Exchange under the symbol AEM, trades in Canada in the symbol AEG. Sean has been with Agnico Eagle since 1985. That's a beautiful thing. Sean Boyd, welcome to TFNN.
Great to be here, Tom.
You know, I'm looking at 1985. You have seen quite a bit in the gold market, haven't you?
Lots of ups and downs. So the company's been around 55 years, and half of that time I've been here. And even before that, I used to be an auditor at Ernst & Young and do some work over here. So I think 30 years I've been walking through the front door.
That's amazing. So talk to me. You've had a heck of a day out here today. You know, talk to me about, your earnings out here today and what's going on with Agnico Eagle.
Well, we've had a tough year, and 2011 was really difficult for us. We had been working hard for the previous 4 to 5 years, building 5 brand new mines from scratch around the world. One of those new mines, we had some ground stability issues in October. We had to suspend mining operations. It really hurt our share price, and we've been struggling since then with some cost issues at our Canadian Arctic project called Meadowbank. We've had to revise the mine plan. So the market was sort of reacting badly to that news through 2011, and we came out last night with a market update, an update on our fourth quarter and earnings, as you mentioned, but really we gave people an outlook going forward, which I guess is not as bad as people had expected. And despite losing a great asset like Goldex, we still see production growth coming out of 4 of our remaining 5 mines. We still saw some great exploration news, and I think more importantly for us, in a tough business, the gold business is tough, we were able to continue our track record of paying a dividend. We've paid our 30th annual consecutive dividend, and we increased it by 25%.
Now talk to me. You know, it's amazing, and I've followed you guys for years, and that was from 2000 to really, you know, almost basically up to 2008, you were actually the strongest gold equity, you know, and I follow 40 of them, so it was pretty amazing. So it's interesting in the concept when you're talking about today. And of course, you know, it looks to me like the market recognizes now you opened low, but I mean the bottom line is that you're 15% off the low today.
That's right. And if you look at the track record, and we've been at it for quite a while here, as you indicated at the top, and if we look at our 20-year performance, even factoring in a very dismal 2011, we still outperformed a lot of the major players in the gold space. And we did it because we kept our story simple. We never, ever sold away an ounce of gold forward. We've always avoided political risk. We've always made room for a dividend in our strategy and looked after the shareholder from a dividend perspective. And mining's a tough business. In our 55-year history, we've had many more ups than downs.
But yes,
when you have those down years, you just sort of regroup, and that's what we've been doing, and that's the plan that we laid out yesterday.
Now, inside, you know, your releases this morning and your numbers, the headwinds. Talk to me about how do foreign exchange losses come up? Is that because the dollar's getting stronger? Or what exactly was that inside those numbers?
Well, we're heavily exposed. We report in U.S. dollars, but
yes,
a lot of our cost base is in Canadian dollars. So a lot of that sort of movement from a quarterly basis is just movements in the Canadian-U.S. dollar exchange rate.
Sure. So a lot of the expenses, you know, it is amazing, Sean, isn't it, that when you think about the context, you know, you're in one of the safest countries in the world to do mining, no doubt. But who would ever think that, that your currency would basically be hurting you when the Canadian dollar was, you know, weak for so long and then all of a sudden it roars, right?
It was great when it was weak. It raises your cost structure in U.S. dollars when it rises. And that's just something you have to factor into your planning and your strategy.
When you're looking at the mining sector right now, in fact, you were quoted on Bloomberg earlier saying that you expected that there's going to be several more write-downs in the gold mining business in general. Can you explain that a little?
Well, I think that what we've seen is a real push for growth across the gold industry, and it was markets and investors were rewarding and paying for growth. So companies were after growth, and what was happening in a rising gold price environment, companies were actually lowering their cutoff grade so that they were bringing marginal ounces into these mine plans.
Yes.
And I think companies are starting to revisit some of those assets now and taking a more conservative approach to the mine plan and even forsaking growth and focusing more on quality. And that bodes well for lack of mine supply, which is also positive for the gold price.
Now, you know, getting gold out of the ground, your structure in general has been, you have a few mines that are very, you know, vein rich in gold. So your cost structure there was very minimal. Talk to me about what it's costing to get, you know, gold out of the ground and, you know, basically, you know, to the mill.
It's tough in remote locations, and we certainly experienced that with our Meadowbank mine, which is in the Canadian Arctic, very remote. About a quarter of our cost structure there is energy, and it's really fuel. We power everything at that mine with diesel generators, and not only do we have to consume a lot of fuel, we have to deliver it to the site. So the cost structure there is moved up, and it's about $1,000 an ounce, whereas our mines in Mexico are producing gold for about $400 an ounce. Much better located, different types of mines, open pit, lower development costs. So a lot of it has to do with location. A lot of it has to do with the type of ore body. And we still got some really good profit margins. In fact, the five mines that are running, you know, should generate about $1 billion in mine operating profit in 2012.
You know, now when we look up, you had quite a shakeup inside the company today. Was this a situation that, you know, you looked at the last few years and, you know, you basically had to get everything out here? What was this all about?
Well, we've got some very experienced people that have been with us a long time and really allowed us to transform our business from what was a single asset regional producer to a multi-mine international gold company. And those two individuals have worked extremely hard in the last 5 years building five mines from scratch. And it really wasn't a matter of when they, if they would retire, it was more a matter of when. And the timing here, what it does is allows them to step back, take a break. We're still going to keep them on as consultants, but it allows us to bring up some of that young talent, the bench strength that we've developed as we've built these mines, and that brings a bunch of new ideas and some new energy, and it really lays out sort of the next chapter for us in our long sort of 55-year history. How do we take this company to the next level?
Yeah, well, I can tell you from a personal point of view, it's neat. What I've found in businesses is that, you know, when you come out with the news, when you've had executives like that for a long period of time, you know, it's tough and people get beat up, meaning, you know, because they're doing the job so well. And most of the time when they know they can leave, that's like they know that things are better now, right? I mean, I guess I'm asking you that question.
Yeah, well, it was great today because, you know, you've got individuals that have made a major contribution over many years, and they're well known in the investment community, and we had our conference call this morning.
Yes.
And right off the bat, we had some of the sell side analysts, say hello to, you know, those people and those gentlemen, and we wish them well. And I said, hey, the guy's right here.
Right.
Why don't you say it to him? And
right.
So a guy that's actually retiring and leaving was still in our conference call, said that, you know, the company's got a solid plan, and we're just a big family at the end of the day, and many of us have worked together for more than two decades.
Yeah, and as you said earlier, I mean, you've seen quite a bit. There's no doubt about it. You know, Mexico, you know, it's amazing that how many, number one, miners are down in Mexico. But, you know, Mexico, just as Canada, a great place to do business, right?
We've had nothing but a good experience in Mexico. In fact, we got involved in Mexico back in 2006. That's our best performing operation in terms of consistency. Quarter
Yes.
after quarter, hits its targets. It's low-cost production. There's good exploration potential. We've got a development project very nearby our existing mining operations where our team has a really good skill set to build it. So we see further growth in Mexico, and it's a place that we see a lot of opportunity.
So, you know, you did the large write-down. Can investors expect more write-downs in the future, or are we starting with a clean slate here?
Well, all of these assets went through a test with the auditors this year, and the one that required an impairment charge was Meadowbank. So the others passed, and I would expect those to continue to pass as we move forward, because several of them are getting larger as we move forward through exploration, which provides opportunities to expand output. So we're not expecting impairment charges on our remaining assets.
And the your average throughout the mines, what is your average cost right now, you know, basically getting gold out of the mine, getting gold out of the ground?
We're forecasting it to be in the high $600 per ounce to get it out of the ground. Last year we were averaged about $580, but in those numbers was our Goldex mine, which was our one of our lowest cost mines, where we had to suspend operations. So when you remove that going forward, the rest of the overall corporate cost structure gravitates upwards because you've eliminated one of your lowest cost operations. So it's still there's still a margin there of over $1,000 an ounce on five mines, four of which are seeing increased production in 2012 versus 2011.
And is the increased production, Sean, from more exploration, or are you just getting into richer oil?
The increased production is from existing assets, and it's from higher grades, particularly at our main asset in the province of Quebec called the Laronde mine.
Okay.
That's where we're seeing better grades as we go deeper.
Okay. Well, listen, you know, we really appreciate you coming on. You know, we appreciate the update. You know, I look forward to, you know, following you, you know, as we do each and every day. And I can tell you, you know, it's got to be pretty cool that you've been at that same company since 1985. I mean, you saw gold at 252, 282, you know.
We saw it at 250. We saw the share price in the $3 range. And when gold was 250, we were probably one of the only companies that didn't have a hedge book. So we were selling at spot gold price. And we had to be very disciplined in how we managed our business without a hedge book. And we were okay with that, because our job isn't to financially engineer this place. It's to find the gold as cheaply as we can and get it out of the ground as cheaply as we can.
Right. And in the future, you plan on, just as you have in the past, you're not going to be hedging. And I guess the currency situation, it's just something you have to deal with, right? Because you do so much business in Canada.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. We just manage that. And we're not going to get into the game of hedging gold. We've never done that. And it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, good for you. Because, you know, it always blows my mind. I remember the first big hedge I saw that ever blew up, and it wasn't a gold company. It happened to be Procter & Gamble. You know, a bank got hold of Procter & Gamble in the 70s and sold them a bill of goods, and it was like, oh, my God. It was hard to believe that, you know, people think they're buying a beautiful, huge, you know, production retailer, and all of a sudden they blew up on foreign currency.
Yeah, the most successful gold businesses are the ones that are the simplest, where you've got simple operations in understandable operations in safe parts of the world, low political risk with exploration upside, and you haven't financially engineered the revenue stream. You're exposed to the commodity.
That's a beautiful thing. Well, listen, we appreciate you being with us, and no doubt, you know, the great news for everyone, there's no doubt about it, is that, you know, you came out, you know, the announcement this morning didn't look that great, there's no doubt about it, but the market spoke, and the market said, listen, you're not going to trade at $31, you're going to be trading at 37. That's
right.
That's a beautiful thing.
That's exactly it. That's a good summary.
It's absolutely huge. Sean, you have a great one, a safe one. Of course, we look forward to having you back on TFNN.
Okay, great. Thanks, Tom.
Thanks so much. That was Sean Boyle, folks. He's the Vice Chairman, Chief Executive Officer, Agnico Eagle, AEM. And no doubt, it's pretty amazing, because, folks, what you have seen is that, you know, depending on how long you've been listening, I knew that I had to go test this high volume bar. And the bottom line, you get that test with 36 million shares versus 132 million. This is Tom O'Brien. This is TFNN. You stay right there, folks. We are going to be coming right back.